Hi guys! In this video, I'm going to give you 5 tips that can help you avoid getting high hamstring tendinopathy. I'm first going to just quickly recap why the condition develops, and then we'll go into how you can prevent it from actually happening to you. So my name is Maryke. I'm the physiotherapist from sportsinjuryphysio.com, where you can get online physiotherapy assessment as well as treatment for your injuries. Have a look at the description of this video if you would like a link to my website. Excellent. So what is high hamstring tendinopathy and why does it develop? High hamstring tendinopathy develops where the hamstring tendons come together in a conjoined tendon and attaches to your sit bone. So high hamstring. And it's due to mechanical overload. So it's an overuse injury. And with mechanical overload, it basically just means the forces that went through it was too high, or it happened too often and the tendon didn't get enough time to recover. And so tendons are really good at withstanding tensile forces, which is pulling forces along the line of the tendon. So if that's your tendon, these type of forces, they're really strong and good at absorbing those. They don't really like compression much. And for this condition specifically, compression plays a large role in why it happens. So if we think of what type of thing will compress your high hamstring tendon, it's anything that wraps the tendon around your sit bone so that it compresses against your sit bone. So it's positions where your hip is bent up. So if I can demonstrate that for you, if you can imagine, if you can imagine the hamstring tendon attaching to your sit bone, so if I lift my leg up, can you see that the hamstring is pulling tight over there and it's going to compress that tendon a little bit? Now, what type of positions will cause, or what type of activities can cause that tendon to compress while it has to work? So if we think of running specifically, running up hills, running fast with high knees, if we think of strength and conditioning, doing squats, lunges, deadlifts, anything where the hip flexes will cause the tendon to go around the bone there. Now, remember, that's a normal thing to happen. It's not a problem for the tendon to go around there. It's only when the force that you ask it to absorb is much higher than what it's used to. So you've not prepared it for it, because normal strength and conditioning, we use progressive overload, which means we train it a little bit harder than what it's used to, and then it recovers and it can do more. But if instead of doing small increments of increase in load, you do a massive one, that can be part of the cause why it develops. It can also just be that you don't give it enough time to recover. So remember that our tendons, just like our muscles and everything else, sustains microtrauma when we exercise. And that is absolutely normal. And that's what stimulates them to grow stronger. But now, that's why you also need your recovery time after exercise bout to allow the tendon to recover. So if you do a hard exercise session, tendon recovers fully. You can do another hard one, tendon recovers fully, and you won't get injured. If, however, you do a hard training session, recover halfway, do another one, recover halfway, do another one, can you see that if you do one when you're only halfway recovered, that's the strength you're training at now. Now you do another one, so you get microtrauma, you only recover halfway, now you train it again. So that tendon becomes weaker and weaker over time. So that's an overuse, typical way that an overuse injury happens. So not allowing enough recovery time is an important thing there. Okay, which actually means that I'm kind of into how to prevent this condition. The first thing is to really monitor your recovery and your fatigue. I put fatigue in that sentence because there is good evidence to show that mental fatigue and physical fatigue can contribute to these type of injuries. Because if you're tired physically and mentally, your body just doesn't recover that well. Make sure you allow enough recovery time according to the training that you've done. So let's think about running specifically. How can it become a problem? If you do easy running sessions, you recover much more quickly. Also, if you're fitter, you'll recover more quickly between sessions. So a common mistake is for people who aren't that well trained, they don't have that many years of hard training behind them, to try and train as often as somebody who is really experienced with training and has done it for ages. Because that experienced person their body will actually recover more quickly than yours if you're a novice runner or not quite on the same level as them. Then if you, somebody who are well trained and really fit normally, but you've had a bit of a break, you've had a month off, or you had an injury or something like that, coming back, your body will actually not recover as quickly and it will sustain a little bit more micro damage than before. So you've got to adjust for that when you look at your training schedule. Hard running sessions. So it's easy to realize that after a track session or a hill session that you've done specifically for that, you need more recovery time. It computes easily in one's head that that's a hard session. But now, don't forget, if you're doing most of your training runs really hilly runs or a lot of hilly races and stuff, those are hard sessions and you're going to need more recovery time after those. So you've got to start to learn how your body feels when it needs more recovery or when it's fully recovered. And that's a very personal thing. There are very telltale signs, like for instance, if your muscles are remaining tight and stiff, it doesn't matter how much you roll them and things, that's a sign that they're just not recovering enough. If you're really tired all the time, that can be a sign that you're not recovering enough. So go and read up about that, because that's really important if you want to avoid this condition. Then the second thing is avoid large increases in load on the hamstring tendon. So if we think of, again, the running type sessions that strains the hamstring tendon or loads that tendon specifically in a compressed position, it'll be hill running and it'll be fast running. So if you're not used to hill running and fast running, have a look and make sure that you don't increase your load on that tendon too much by doing a sudden increase in loads of hill running or sudden increase in loads of speed running or putting a hill session and a speed session in the same week, for instance. So make sure that you allow for it to adapt with small doses. Then thirdly, with regards to running style, some runners tend to overstride. So with overstride, it means that you're placing your heel quite far in front of your body when you land. I wonder if I can demonstrate that to you a little bit. So if we think of, get that back a bit. If we think of running, so when you run, you obviously bring your leg forward and then you can place it anywhere from there, there, there. If I'm going to place it there, can you see that first of all, I'm creating a braking force, but also my hip is in a lot more flexed position when I land. Whereas if I place it slightly more under my center of gravity, I'm not really braking so much as I run, and my hip isn't as flexed. So if you find that you've got a big overstride when you run, it may be worth actually trying to change that. That you land with your foot closer to your center of gravity, so more underneath you, and also maybe just up your step rate a little bit. So if you're running with quite a low step rate, by increasing that, you're keeping your strides a little bit shorter. So that can be useful. Then fourthly is avoid deep, sustained hamstring stretches. I've actually had several runners who's given this condition to themselves by taking up yoga and thinking that the more they stretch, the better it will be for injury prevention. So it's important to know, first of all, that there is no evidence that doing regular stretching prevents injuries. There's some evidence that having a level of flexibility can help prevent muscle strains, but for the rest of it, not really. And to be honest, there's strong evidence that overstretching the hamstring with really deep, sustained hamstring stretches can cause a hamstring tendinopathy, because it really can compress that bit. So if you feel you need to improve your hamstring flexibility and it's feeling quite tight back there, it may be a better option to do gentler stretches or use dynamic movements where you go in and out of the position or hold it for shorter periods. Or just plain don't force the movements, just ease into what feels comfortable. Nothing in this world is good for you if you overdo it. So find your balance there or seek advice if you're really struggling with it. Then, fifth is watch what you sit on. There are a depressing number of patients who also came to me who actually got this condition from sitting on really hard surfaces and especially like leaning forward to chat to somebody. Because if you think about it, sitting on a hard surface, you're already compressing part of the tendon there. If you then lean forwards, you wrap it around the sit bone a bit more, so you compress it even more. And the longer you do that for, the more starved that part of the tendon may become. Now, sitting on a hard bench is really not a problem. It's just about how long you do it for, how comfortable you are on it. If you're not comfortable, do something, place something underneath you. Just don't sit there for ages and then only hours later realize that you've run into trouble. So I don't want you to avoid sitting on hard benches forever and ever and ever. Just think about the length of time you're doing it for and how you actually feel when you're sitting on it. Excellent. So to recap those five things, one is think about your recovery. Think about your tendon specifically and think about the type of training you've done and the races you've done and how your legs are feeling. Second is don't increase the types of activities that can annoy the hamstring tendon too suddenly. Build it up slowly over time. Third, if you're overstriding when you run, see if you can just bring that in a little bit, that you don't stretch it quite so far when you're running. Fourth is avoid very deep sustained hamstring stretches. There are other options that you can do rather. And lastly, watch what you sit on. Avoid those really hard surfaces and sitting on there leaning forwards, chatting with somebody in the pub for ages. Good. If you need any more help with the injury, you're always welcome to consult me via video call. The link to my website is in this video, but if you've got any questions, you're welcome to email me or message me as well. There's a form you can fill in on the website as well. Take care.